You may feel totally alone at this time. You may feel like you're facing a crisis that you just can't handle. I want to remind you that you are not alone. The Holy Spirit is there to help you. Let's go to Father God in the name of Jesus, asking for an extra measure of the Holy Spirit. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, who told us in the scriptures that, Lord, if we ask for bread, you won't give us a stone. If we ask for fish, you won't give us a scorpion or a snake. How much more so will you give us the Holy Spirit in this hour of need? We ask you, Lord, to pour the Holy Spirit down upon us, that, Lord, as we see the wonders of your creation, we can call out unto you for the Holy Spirit to come and create on us a new spirit, to give us the strength and the power we need at this hour in the midst of these needs. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may feel overwhelmed at this moment. I want to encourage you to just get up, go out into the wonders of creation, go on a prayer walk, observe the beauty of God's creation. If autumn has shifted into winter, not only in the world around you, but in your own heart, you feel like, know that God is with you and that spring is coming. The Holy Spirit, as He renews creation day after day, as He works in and through all that has breath and life, all the animals, the rustling of the branches, the trees, all the beauty of creation, may you know that God is with you and He's promised He'll never leave you nor forsake you. The Holy Spirit is right there to assist you. The tragedy is that we try to do this work all too frequently that we feel God has called us to do without the direction of the Spirit. What was so unique about David that separated him from everyone else is that he would seek God for guidance each time he encountered a difficulty, an enemy, and he'd wait upon the Lord, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, he would get the direction, and God was able to use him. It's so critical that you and I can surrender ourselves to the Lord, stay out of the way, and let the Holy Spirit move through us at this time. Without the Holy Spirit, we would not know the power of the living God. We would not recognize His wonders in creation. We would not see Jesus at work in our life at this time. The Holy Spirit is not an influence. He's the third person of the Holy Trinity. And Jesus, before He went to heaven, He said He would not leave us alone, but He would send His Comforter, the Holy Spirit. As we look and seek God, as we ask Him to come and renew life within us, the Holy Spirit comes down upon us, frequently giving us a new prayer language where we can begin to praise God and seek Him, sometimes known as a gift of tongues. At other times, He'll give various other gifts of the Spirit. And He begins to work in our life in the midst of the trials and tribulations as we seek God and let the Holy Spirit work in us to make us better as we get older rather than bitter. For truly we know, under the direction of the Holy Spirit, that as we observe all the wonders of creation and all that God is doing in, through, and with us, around us, that He will never leave us nor forsake us. And He'll send the Comforter of the Holy Spirit. Now we need the Holy Spirit to begin to move in our lives. For He is the agent of salvation who shows us our guilt, as John 16, verses 7 and 8 says. He reveals to us the truth about Jesus, who's the way, the truth, and the life. Who tells us in John 14, 12, Behold, I tell you the truth. He says, Behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in me, you'll do even greater works than this, because I'm going to my Father. Whatever He asks the Father in my name, I will do it. And what does He do? We ask the Father in the name of Jesus. He sends the Holy Spirit. And we see Him do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we could even ask or think. You see, God is not limited. What we do is often get so filled with self, there's no room for the Holy Spirit to work in us and through us. So the challenge is to forget about ourselves for a few moments, focus in upon God, observe all that He is doing around us, and see the Holy Spirit at work. Let all that hath breath and life praise the Lord. God breathed upon man and became a living being after he was made from clay. And God has breathed upon all of His creation. And all that has breath and life praising God, we see the Holy Spirit at work. We need to be converted to come to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior and receive the Holy Spirit, as John chapter 3, verses 3 through 6 says, and John chapter 20, verse 22. And then we need to become part of that divine nature of God, as 2 Peter 1, 4 refers to it as. And we need to be filled with the Spirit. We need to be filled with the Spirit in order that He may directly flow in and through our lives, guiding us and directing us and leading us. The Holy Spirit is there. And all we need to do is say, Father, I come to you now, knowing that every good and perfect gift flows from you, and I'm asking you to send the Holy Spirit upon me. As John chapter 12, verse 24 and 25 says, and we look at God's word, and this is what it says in John, that's John chapter 12, verses 24 and 25. And he tells us here that he says, very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains a single grain. There again, see, the Lord uses over and over throughout the scriptures examples from creation. And all too frequently, we become so human-orientated, disassociated from all of creation, we're not able to see what Jesus is actually saying to us because of our ignorance of creation. So we see the Word of God working in conjunction with the creation of God to teach us spiritual truths. So once again, Jesus said, truly, truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will be my servant also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Thank you, Jesus. We surrender to Jesus. We serve him, and he sends the Holy Spirit to help us do the job that he has given us to do. And we see it all around us. And as we do this, we discover what it means to become productive and filled with the Spirit and see him do, as the scripture says, exceedingly beyond what we can even ask or think. I see miracles unfold in my life. It's not me who's doing it. I got to stay out of the way. If I get puffed up with pride and Satan's constantly walking around seeking to destroy, I get in the way of the Holy Spirit and he's not free to do his work because I am not the one that should be glorified. As John said, that I must decrease in order that he might increase, but that they might see it in good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. That's what the work of the Holy Spirit. And God deserves all glory, honor, and praise, for I can do nothing in it myself. So as long as I can stay out of the way, be yielded to God, and let the Holy Spirit work in me, I will see him do the miraculous. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8, 13, for if you live according to your sinful nature, you'll die. But by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. And that's so critical, particularly when it comes to pride. It must be put aside and live and move under the direction of the Holy Spirit. Through the work of the Holy Spirit and the redeeming work of Jesus Christ, the sinful deeds of the body are put to death, and we're free to truly live if we will but obey. As 1 Samuel chapter 15, 22 says, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. Obedience is so critical. And it's the Holy Spirit that constantly prods us to do what is right. Yes, there's many times that I fall into the flesh, and things upset me, or things don't go right, and I start to get tense. And then I'll start feeling this conviction, the Holy Spirit, as it may be referred to. Then I start feeling like I was in a fire, and smoke alarms are going off. Now you're falling in the flesh. You better stop. You better back up. You better halt. And again, that spells out whenever I'm hungry, angry, lonely, or tired of a tendency to fall in the flesh, I got to halt and get back into the Holy Spirit. Because allowing the deeds of the flesh, to work ends up in death. And obeying God is absolutely essential for life. Acts 5:32 refers to the Holy Spirit whom God has given to those who obey him. So we must surrender our life to Jesus, desire to seek God and obey him, and just continue to let the Holy Spirit work in our life, because obeying means to surrender to God. And what's the opposite of sin? S-I-N. Okay, and spell it backwards, N-I-S. Now I surrender, offering ourselves to God so that no sin can reign in our mortal bodies, but offering the parts of our body to him as instruments of righteousness. And we see all this, some refer to it as a balance of nature, but it's really the Holy Spirit at work in all the creation around us. Listen, and let's apply Romans chapter 6, 11 to 14 at this particular time in our lives. He says, so you also must consider yourself dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, don't let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey your passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. Thank you, Jesus. And that grace means that the Holy Spirit can then begin to work in our lives and through our lives. Thank you, Lord, to just be able to experience His fullness of power. Sin comes in so many different disguises that we're unable to even recognize it frequently unless we allow the piercing sword of the Spirit to work in our lives. As Ephesians 6:17 says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. For the Word of God is living and active, as Hebrews chapter 4:12 says, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even the dividing of the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow. It judges things we do that are wrong, as well as the things that we should have done but didn't do because of fear, apathy, and unbelief in our lives. Oh, how we need to let God to work in our lives. Here it is, the Word of God, Hebrews chapter 4:12. It talks about that it's like a double-edged sword that actually divides the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow, and it judges the thoughts and intents of our heart. And that's what the sword of the Spirit does. And it searches out that sin in our life. It roots it out. It cuts it out. It shows it to us. It convicts us as such. Not only does the Spirit condemn sin, but He also brings us face to face with the love of God manifested through Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Oh, we need you, Holy Spirit, to come and renew life within us. I want to just encourage you at this moment just to begin to pause and think about it in your heart and mind. Observe all of God's wonderful creation. Let your prayer be, Holy Spirit, come upon me through your power. Renew within me a new life, a new spirit. Help me, Holy Spirit. Draw me into the reality of salvation provided through our resurrection Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because along with the eternal gift of eternal life, Jesus has given us the gifts of the Spirit that we read about in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 to 14, and the Holy Spirit Himself. And that's why we're told in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, to remind them that don't have a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, love, and sound mind, or self-discipline. We have to have that kind of power working in us at this particular time. Oh, we need the power of the Holy Spirit. Poor people are being crushed. The war on poverty has become the war on the impoverished. Wickedness is so prevalent in our world at this particular time. How do we survive? Except through the Holy Spirit. So we pray, come, Holy Spirit, come. Daily surrendering unto the living God and allowing our helper, the Holy Spirit, to work in us and through us, which results in the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control, as Galatians 5:22 23 says. So let's move into the wonders of creation. Let our prayer be, come, Holy Spirit, with your power upon me. Renew life within me at this moment as I totally surrender to you. Yes, come, Holy Spirit, come. Come with your power. Renew life within me. Guide me into truth, where Satan walks around like a roaring lion, seeking to devour. How critical it is that you and I daily read the Word of God under the direction and power of the Holy Spirit. So as you begin to read the Scriptures, ask the Holy Spirit to guide and direct you. As you go on your prayer walk in the midst of creation, as you open your heart and mind and begin to see all of God's wonders of creation, seek the Holy Spirit. Seek the Holy Spirit, because the hour is late. It's so essential that you do this. Satan's walking around like a roaring lion, seeking may devour. 1 Peter 1:8. Maybe he can't get you off into drugs or alcohol or pornography or all this other stuff, but he'll just try to puff you up, get you to become an ego addict. And what does ego stand for? Edging God out. So he'll try to get you to do that. So you got to go back to the Bible. And what does a Bible spell out? Basic instructions before leaving earth. And as you read the book of Revelations, you'll see that Satan is so angry because he's been tossed out of heaven, and he's doing everything he can right now, creating all this chaos and confusion. So how do we overcome this? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony under the direction and power of the Holy Spirit. And that's why we need the Holy Spirit to work in our lives every moment, every hour, every day. This happens as we humble ourselves before God. Humble ourselves before God, receiving Jesus Christ and trusting His Lordship and His love to dwell in us and work through us constantly. How we need the Holy Spirit. and how we need to be continually reminded of God's ever-abiding presence. That's why get out of the asphalt jungles. Come out from behind the four walls this very moment. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Begin to move into the wonders of creation and see that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as he provided for the birds, he'll provide for you. As you consider the lilies, he'll take care of you. As you see the big tree, when you were walking through the trees, learn from the trees, that they've been there year after year through change after change, and God will be with you. Remember, it's the Holy Spirit, as Ephesians chapter 5, 18 says, who will transform us, conforming us in the image of Christ, as Romans 8, 29 says, are forming Christ in us, as Galatians 4, 19 says. The Holy Triune God. The Father sends the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit moves the power and message of Christ in our life, and Christ glorifies the Father. And in Christ, the Helper shows us we have identity and we have purpose. We don't need the world's endorsement. They can say all they want about us. They can lie about us. They can try to do all this stuff. But we know who we are in Christ Jesus, for Jesus is Lord of our lives. That's what the Holy Spirit puts. And as a result, we're truly free. And as Galatians 5:1 says, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. So stand firm then, and don't let yourself be burned again by the yoke of slavery to sin. We're free from condemnation and the slavery of sin. God's word shows us that. Ephesians chapter 4, 22 to 24. Look it up. Read it yourself. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. And now we have a deep desire for the Holy Spirit to come and work his power within us and renewing our life and to love God and just follow the leading of the Spirit, as Romans 8, 13 to 14 says. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, as 2 Corinthians 3, 17 says, for the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. This freedom provided by Jesus Christ and dwelling power of the Holy Spirit is not freedom for us to do what we want to do, as 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 23 to 24 says, but to do what we should do, as Romans chapter 6, 18 to 23 says. Wow, thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Spirit. See the Holy Spirit at work through all of Scripture and through all the wonders of creation. For we have been liberated to praise God like all the rest of creation. We've been liberated to serve God. And we see this, as 1 Thessalonians tells us in chapter 1, verse 9. They tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God. That's what the Holy Spirit does in our lives. And an idol is anything that becomes more important to us than the living and true God. Again, we've got to take our eyes off ourselves. Look to God and the power of His Spirit. Because if we're so filled with self, the Holy Spirit can't do much against us, much in us and through us. So we need the Holy Spirit to come. And so we be emptied of self and filled with the Spirit. When we're set free from serving idols, we discover the freedom and joy that comes from helping other people who are in need. Jesus declared in Matthew 25, verse 40, whatever you did to the least of these, he said, even so you've done it unto me. He says that so clear in his word. And yet why are so many people having to live in their cars and live outside? And because all these church buildings are closed and the people of God have closed their hearts to the poor and needy. And so many that were once on fire with the Holy Spirit, part of the charismatic movement, had now become part of a prosperity cult that have totally forgotten about Jesus Christ, that are more concerned about getting wealth and power and use that as their success as a form of that they're close to God. They become totally deceived. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a person sows, that shall they also reap. And if you sow to the flesh, if you want a little more of Jesus so you get a whole lot more of this world, you're headed to hell. Because God has been so decisive in his word that whatever you've done to the least of these, he said, even so you've done it unto me. Brothers and sisters, do not be deceived by a church that has been infected by a spirit of materialism, where some members of that church are more concerned about what's happening in the White House than they are in God's house. We need to get back with God. We need to come to know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and know that he's the one that sits on the throne. Not this president, that president, this governor, that mayor. Jesus Christ is Lord. And we need the Holy Spirit to come down upon us and grant us a holy boldness that we can stand up and say, here I stand, I can do no other. And God has called me to do this and I must do it. Remember, the Holy Spirit is a gift from the Father. And Jesus said, if you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? As Luke chapter 11, 13 says, we need the Holy Spirit What I need, what the staff of New Life Evangelistic Center needs, what my family needs, is more of the Holy Spirit. God is a mighty God. And the Holy Spirit was dealing with me with that as I was prepared to travel the other morning. And my heart, I got up, I turned on our radio station on the Here's Help Network, and there's Pastor Ray talking about the Holy Spirit, and God just confirming in me, Larry, you need more of the Holy Spirit. Larry, pray for more of the Holy Spirit. And I need the Holy Spirit. You need the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come now and work within us. We see the Holy Spirit just doing miracles all over in the Scriptures. All we have to do is simply receive Him and make room for Him. Our part is not to strike the rock, but speak to the rock, as we saw as necessary in Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 to 13. Speaking the rock in simplicity, quietly, expectingly, claiming the Holy Spirit to enter in. More a willing than a father who will give good gifts to his children, will the Father on high bestow the Holy Spirit on those who ask Him. Let's now receive that power from on high. The world is crying out for it. So many people are crying out to see the love of God, the power of the Holy Spirit working through the people of God. But what happens is we become so busy inflating our own egos, trying to get the applause of people, that we forget about the will of God in our lives. And we forget about the power of the Holy Spirit. We become so filled with fear. Don't give me another sermon on faith. Help me to see faith working through you, where you're going to confront those principalities and powers through the power of God. That's what I have to do on a daily basis. I can't let the devil make me bitter over the injustice and ungodliness and wickedness I see of people who want to keep 1411 Locust closed. I got to pray for their salvation. And I got to pray that the Holy Spirit will come work within me. The helper, the Holy Spirit. His coming will bless and strength and invigorate me and invigorate you for serving God, both now and for all eternity, serving God as well as those His children He bring our way. Through Christ, we can receive the promise that God gives in Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 25 and 26. It can become ours today when He clearly says, I will sprinkle clean water on you and you'll be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities, from all your idols. I'll give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove from you the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Wow. Lord, remove the heart of stone. As this promise unfolds in your life, you're going to be moved from having an indifferent heart to the plight of the poor, the elderly, the handicapped, the blind. And you're going to be moved and healed of an indifferent heart of stone and fear that, has become totally indifferent to the needs of others. Your heart's going to be melted, and you're going to have a caring heart of compassion that's going to come forth. And how we need to believe God for the miracle of Ezekiel chapter 37 at this time, when we see the Spirit of God coming into a valley of dry, dead bones, and life comes into these bones, and an army of compassionate people come forth. Lord God, send your Holy Spirit upon all who profess the name of Jesus. Lord, deliver them from a spirit of materialism at this hour. Lord God, let your charismatic movement, let the Holy Ghost movement come, Lord, like we saw 20, 30, 40 years ago, Lord. Deliver them from that spirit of materialism right now that has come upon their lives, where they want to name it and claim it, rather than, Lord, letting your love flow through them into the lives of the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, the homeless, those are crying out to you at this moment. Help us, Holy Spirit, to help them in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. At this time, our prayer needs to be, Heavenly Father, send the Holy Spirit. Come, my promised helper, come at this hour. Infuse with me the power from on high, the power I see at work through your word and through all the wonders of creation. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Guide me, direct me, empower me so I may be an instrument of healing and hope in the lives of the hurting and homeless. Precious Jesus, please replace the fear in my life with faith, that I may be filled with a holy boldness that came upon Peter in Acts chapter 4, verse 8, and the other believers in Acts chapter 4, verse 31. And after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Heavenly Father, come. Send the Holy Spirit. Help us not only speak the word of God boldly, help us to live it. Give us the power to confront, Lord God, the spirit of idolatry and materialism and ungodliness, Lord God, and injustice at this hour. Give us holy boldness. We ask this in Jesus' name. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.